biology.
So welcome back to this next class, whereby in the first part of the class we looked at classification. Now in this next part of the class, let's look at the kingdom. So we have five kingdoms of classification, whereby the first kingdom is kingdom Monera, comprising of the bacteria. We have kingdom Protoctista, comprising of the algae and protozoa. We have kingdom Fungi, comprising of the mushrooms, the algae, and we have the not algae, we have mushroom, yeast, and the mold. We also have kingdom Plantae, comprising of all the plants, and then kingdom Animalia, comprising of all the animals. So let's look at the first one, which is kingdom Monera. So kingdom Monera, this kingdom can also be called kingdom Prokaryota. So you see that they are very small unicellular organisms. They also lack a nuclear membrane, hence the name prokaryotic cells, and hence also the name Prokaryota. So these cells are prokaryotic. So they mainly comprise of only the bacteria. So example, we have the Vibrio cholerae, which leads to a disease called cholera. So let's look at the other kingdom, whereby we have kingdom Protoctista, or it can be called kingdom Protista. So these are mainly unicellular organisms, and then also these are eukaryotic cells. Now these are eukaryotic cells, and this kingdom can also be called kingdom Eukaryota. So the examples of organisms under this kingdom, we see that we have the algae, we have the slime mold, and also we have the protozoa. So let's look at the next kingdom, where we have kingdom Fungi. So in kingdom Fungi, you see that some of these organisms are unicellular, while some of these organisms are multicellular. So also these organisms under kingdom Fungi, they don't have chlorophyll. They behave like plants, yes, but they don't have chlorophyll. So also we see that most of these organisms are saprophytes. So examples of these organisms, we have the yeast, we have the molds, and also we have the mushrooms. So we see that some are saprophytic, they behave saprophytically, while some they behave like parasites. Example, we have the graminae, we have the Pusinia graminae species, which mainly behaves as a parasite. So let's look at the kingdom Plantae. So in kingdom Plantae, we see that it comprises of all the plants. So these organisms are mainly multicellular organisms. So they mainly contain chlorophyll, whereby chlorophyll, we see that this is the agent by which these plants make food. So the organisms under kingdom Plantae also are autotrophic, meaning that they make their own food using simple materials, be it light or be it chemical materials in the environment. So these organisms include the division, which is division bryophyta. Division bryophyta comprises of the moss plants. We have division pteridophyta, which mainly comprises of the ferns. So this is the division pteridophyta. And then finally, we have the division spermatophyta, which mainly comprises of all the seed-bearing plants. So concerning division in plant or kingdom Plantae, the divisions, we're going to look at them in form 3. The next one is kingdom Animalia. So kingdom Animalia mainly comprises of all these organisms are multicellular organisms. And then the organisms under kingdom Animalia, we see that they are heterotrophic. Remember, in animals we say that they are autotrophic, but in plants rather we say that they are autotrophic, while now in animals they are heterotrophic. So heterotrophic means that they look for their own food, and they also take in complex food materials. So these organisms also reproduce sexually and asexually. So examples of the phylum under kingdom Animalia, we see that we have phylum Chordata, whereby these are the organisms which comprise or have a backbone. And then we have phylum Arthropoda, whereby these are organisms without a backbone. So in simple terms, phylum Chordata, they may be called the vertebrates, while phylum Arthropoda, they may be called the invertebrates. So let's look at now the binomial nomenclature. So what is binomial nomenclature? So you say this, that this is the scientific double naming system of living organisms. So also very much avoid saying that this is the double naming system of living of organisms. I'm at this the double naming system, leave it like that. So it's wrong. So you must always say that it is the scientific double naming system of living organisms. So it must be scientific. And to add more information, we'll say that this is the scientific double naming of living organisms, whereby an organism is given a species name and a genus name, or a genus name and a species name. So that is the complete answer. So in binomial nomenclature, you see that the organism is given the first name, which is the genus name, and the second name, which is the species name. So the genus name can also be called the generic name, and the species name can also be called the specific name. So the genus name must begin with a capital letter, and the species name must begin with a small letter. So let's look at different examples of organisms and their scientific name. So you have, for example, the human. So human being, the scientific name is Homo sapiens. So you see that the genus name began with a capital letter, and then the species name began with a small letter. Also take note that these names are underlined separately. So they are underlined separately. So when typing, we'll see that they must be italicized. And in this case, they will be italicized since they were typed. In the rules, we are going to expound more on this. So let's look at the next one, which is the dog. So the scientific name of the dog is Canis familiaris. So the genus name Canis begins with a capital letter, familiaris begins with a small letter. So we have the bean, whereby the bean is called Phaseolus vulgaris. And then we also have the lion, whereby the lion is Panthera leo. We have the leopard, which is Panthera pardus. And then finally, we have the cockroach, whereby the scientific name of the cockroach is Periplaneta americana. So next time you see a cockroach in your home, don't say that I've seen a cockroach. Say that I've seen a Periplaneta americana. So I'm going to spray it maybe with an insecticide. Yeah, at least that will make some sense. So anyway, let's look at the rules in binomial nomenclature, whereby you see that the first name, which is the genus name, must begin with a capital letter, and the second name, which is the species name, must begin with a small letter. So these names also must be underlined separately as the third rule. Also, these names at the fourth rule will say that they must be italicized when typed. So when you type them, you must italicize them. When you write them with your hand or free hand, you must underline them. So when typing, italicize. When written with free hand, underline them separately. So a newly discovered organism must be given a scientific name. So those are the rules. So let's look at the specimen collection. So first of all, let's begin with specimen. What is a specimen? So specimen, this is anything taken in the laboratory to be used for experiment. So anything you take in the laboratory to be used for experiment is called a specimen. So there are different apparatus for collecting specimen, whereby the first one, we have a putter, whereby a putter is used to suck small crawling organisms on back of trees or on the walls. We have the bait traps for trapping rodents, we have the collecting jars, and then we have the traps for capturing different types of organisms. We have the net, we have the hand gloves for safety, we have the forceps, and then finally we have the magnifying glass. So finally, again, let's look at the precautions in handling different specimens. So you should only collect the number of specimens that you need. Also, never harm a specimen after collecting. So all the specimens should be handled with great care as the third precaution. So the fourth precaution will say that highly mobile organisms should be immobilized. So if an organism keeps running, you should carefully immobilize the organisms to carry out experiments. And then finally, you should never destroy the habitats of these organisms. So take the organisms carefully, not to destroy the habitat. And then finally, after conducting the experiment and you are finished with the experiment, you should always return the specimen to their habitat. So that has been today's class. So let's meet on the next class now, as we now look into the cell and dive more into the cell. Thank you. Biology.